Hi, good afternoon. My name is Ted Wells. I'm Chief Strategy Officer at STEMconnector here in Washington, D.C. We are coming to you to present our STEM Higher Education Council kickoff town hall today. We've got a number of great speakers from the higher education space. We're joined here today by Dr. Richard Rhodes and his team from Austin Community College in Austin, Texas. We also will have a number of other speakers that are coming to you from places like California, Iowa, New York, and you name it. So it will be a great 2 hours. A couple housekeeping notes before we get started. You will be able, this broadcast will be automatically archived on our website, our YouTube channel, the STEMconnector YouTube channel, as well as on the event page on Google Plus. Also, we will also keep an embedded code on our stemconnector.org/townhall site, so you can go back and reference this. The hashtag today, if you're using Twitter or Google+, is STEM Higher Ed. Might want to capitalize all four letters of STEM and H and E, so kind of get the visual effect. And I'm going to turn it over now to our CEO, Edie Fraser, who's going to give a couple of remarks about the Higher Ed Council. And then we'll introduce you to our first speakers today. So one moment, Edie, and I will turn it to you. There you go. You're on.
Good afternoon, everyone. And how exciting to see the innovation from higher education. So quickly, we want to just applaud the quick growth of this Higher Education Council. And that is chaired by none other than Rob Denson, the president of Des Moines Area Community College. And he said to us that as we learned, we at STEMconnector are focused on where the jobs are and is what we've got to do to build skills training. So it's saying thank you, Rob. And we want to note that we had several universities that had come on with us to work on our STEM Innovation Task Force, our Food and Ag Council, but it was critical that we turn to higher education for leadership, for innovation, for the skills to job, and for best practices, and clearly to meet the new employer demand. So Rob, thank you for your leadership. Second, we want to applaud Dr. Martha Cantor, and we'll go back and introduce her more formally in a minute, but she is a senior advisor on our STEM Higher Education Council, as is universities, community colleges, four-year institutions, and also 25 major corporations, October 8th. Dr. Freeman Habrowski for University of Maryland, Baltimore campus. So what we want to do is also salute a few people very quickly that are senior advisors to us. Sheila Boynton that is there on the phone today. We want to say Jane Oates, the former Assistant Secretary of Labor for Education and Training, Randy Goschel and others. And want to acknowledge Ted Wells, who is managing the call today, for his extraordinary work at STEMconnector and now the Higher Education Council and our Food and Ag Council. And is Brian Jackson is basically thrilled that Brian, you are assisting, and Dr. Tomisha Richards on our staff. So let us just say that we've got about 500 people signed up today. Many of you have teams that are listening. The whole call will be up on YouTube on the site. So you will have breakthrough learnings today from the Higher Education Council. And we'll turn that back to tell you that STEMconnector has absolutely aligned with 6,600, 115 formal members. And now we say the importance of higher education and the extraordinary presentations today. I turn it back to my colleague, Ted Wells. Ted?
Thanks, Edie. You can probably hear me right now. I'm going to introduce our chair and of our Higher Ed Council, who's Benson. Rob is coming to us today not from his home campus in Ankeny, Iowa, but is actually out in Cedar Rapids, right, Rob?
Yes, I'm at Kirkwood Community College. They've given me a great slot in the boardroom. So I was here for a business and industry conference where I had the honor this morning of introducing Mike Rowe, the star of Dirty Jobs, as he talked about skilled workforce and STEM. So it was a very exciting morning.
Great, Rob. Well, let me introduce you briefly, and then Edie can also introduce your partner, Dr. Martha Cantor. So Rob Denson has been president of Des Moines Area College since 2003, and he grew up on a farm near Homestead, Iowa, south of the Amana colonies, and graduated from high school in Marengo. He's the first native-born president, native Iowan-born president of DMAC. He has a B.S. in political science and economics and a master's degree in higher education administration from Iowa State University. He worked for Iowa State as assistant dean for 3 years before moving to Florida, where he serves as assistant dean of students. He graduated at law school from University of Florida and was associate university attorney for 3 years before operating his own law practice for 16 years. So Rob has spent a lot of time both working in higher ed and as a student in higher ed, picking up degrees in a number of places. In 1996, he became president and dean for institutional advancement at Santa Fe Community College in Gainesville, and then he returned to Iowa as president of Northeast Community College in Kalmar, Iowa, where the college saw a 58% enrollment increase during its five-year tenure. Rob believes in success, teams, and positive thinking. He and his wife, Pat, have two children, and it's my pleasure to turn it over to my friend and colleague, Rob Denson, and then Edie will introduce Martha when we turn it over to her.
Thank you very much, and it's great to be on this inaugural call with 500 individuals from all over the country, as well as the panelists here today. I actually started out at a one-room country school, and I am exactly as old as I look. So to go from a one-room school with no technology and an outdoor bathroom to the STEM technology we have today is very, very exciting. DMAC has been a partner, active partner in STEMconnector for 2 years, and this STEMconnector Higher Ed Council that we started this spring is really the outgrowth of us realizing that, you know, STEM is not a flavor of the month, and that higher education, and actually all of education, plays a very big role in STEM and the providing a skilled workforce to the companies that are here. For those of you on the call, I hope you, like we, will be looking for specific things in these presentations from these STEMconnector Higher Education Council members, things that we could take to our, back to our own campuses, things we may want to explore more, get more information. But it's all about really using higher education best practices and implementing them so that we can advance this game of STEM down the road. So, Ted, if you'll move to the PowerPoint, let me kind of talk through a few slides, and then we'll open it up for Martha. All right, it's not on my screen. There we go. Tell me when you're ready. While the slides are being presented, I know Edie mentioned a few individuals, but Edie Frazier, as Executive Director of STEMconnector, has just been a great to work with. Ted, Brian, Talmisha, and the entire STEMconnector team. It is the most aggressively impact-oriented group, aggressive impact-oriented group that I've ever worked with, and it just makes our relationship exceptionally good.
Rob, do you see it up on your screen now? Thank you.
Okay, I see the little screen. Okay, this is a second slide, which it really reinforces what Edie said. You know, Martha Cantor is providing great advice and counsel to us as senior advisor. Freeman Hrabrowski with the University of Maryland at Baltimore County, also a senior advisor, as well as a number of others. You know, we've got the best talent here that we could have to work with companies. And if you go to the STEMconnector website, I tell everyone, go to the bottom of any web page and you'll see who the members of STEMconnector are from the business side of our house. So we're excited about being able to work with them intimately. On the next slide, it just talks about the distinguishing characteristics of the Higher Ed Council. You know, we know we've got to be different. we've got to actually make something happen and allow some end result to come from what all of our work. So we're using boundary breaking. We're including business in a way that's never been included before. We're really there on a demand side, telling us what we need and helping us find talent and get them through the pipeline. And again, we hope at the end of this whole process that we're able to share some best practices with what some companies are doing that they found great success in that we can move over. On the next slide, we talk about STEM 1.0, STEM 2.0. Right now, we know that there is a shortage of skilled workforce. I mean, it's all over the country. In a time where we've got record unemployment in many areas of the country, we've got businesses that can't find the right talent at the right time. The slide you're looking at is our STEM 1.0 slide. Employer demand is coming back strong. The economy is coming back strong. There's onshoring of businesses that may have been sent overseas. They're coming back to the country. So the United States is seeing more and more job demand, skilled workers with specific skills. At the same time, we're having a hard time finding a number of skilled employees for these jobs. So it's STEM is at the intersection of supply and demand. Right now, we don't believe that there is a real alignment, so we've got a zone of missed opportunity. The good news is there are jobs for those individuals that we get in the pipeline and move through, so we need to make sure that we're doing that. The next slide talks about the trademarked STEM 2.0 that STEMconnector has developed. So here, when supply meets demand, we're taking STEM 2.0 and we're going to, because of our business engagement and the business being the driver, we're going to successfully align workforce demand with the jobs that are available and the skilled workforce coming out. And we want to make sure that we have a much more sincere and honest exchange. We're calling it boundary-breaking collaboration. But again, with the companies that are at the table and others joining all the time, we need to make sure that higher education is responsive. The next slide shows our current level of the number of members in the Higher Ed Council. The important thing about this, and we've got about 25 that have come on in a very, very short amount of time. We've only been in operation since March or April of this year. We've got land-grant institutions, four-year, we've got private, we've got Hispanic-serving institutions, historically black colleges and universities, community colleges, and organizations, large online privates. I mean, we really are not missing any sector of the higher education market, and that's what makes this such a vibrant activity. And quite frankly, it's worth our time showing up to take this group to the businesses that need the workers and say, how can we provide a solution? Because if we can't provide a solution, they are going to look somewhere else. And those of us that are serious about leadership in higher education, you know, we don't want to be the has-been or the buggy whip factory or video store. I mean, we want to make sure that we're on target and moving forward as fast as the speed of light. The next slide shows us, this is kind of an overarching kind of flow chart of where we are. Sometimes we complain, and you read about it in the paper, the quality of graduates coming out of the high school. Well, the Higher Education Council realizes that those teachers in the high school, I mean, they deal with other things, but we need to do a better job of equipping teachers in the high schools, elementary, middle, and high, so that they have the best skills so that they can be good STEM educators and receive and give an amount of excitement to these students to get into STEM. And then as you move from left to right on the slide, you've got at the top public and private colleges and universities, you've got business collaborators. We bring in all the state and federal support, and the good news is from the president and the Congress to the governors and the legislators, we have a lot of individuals, you know, they see the writing on the wall. And right now they do see us as in higher education as a solution, so they're giving us tools. And again, we're at a point where we can't disappoint them. So we've got to develop the career pathways in a way and create excitement in a way that gets a result. And the goal is good jobs. You know, Jim Clifton in the book from Gallup, you know, The Coming Jobs Wars says what everyone in the world, and they've surveyed everybody, what everyone in the world wants is a good job. And we know that every good job has a STEM component, so we need to make sure that we're doing our share of that. Now I'll turn it over to Ted to lead off on the agenda. And again, thanks everyone for being here. This is a great business. Higher education needs to respond. And the good news is business is at the table with us as a full partner. And it's not about asking for money. It's about being as consulting and moving the ball down the field. So thank you for being here.
Thanks, Rob. Turn it back over to Edie now.
Rob, thank you. Rob didn't brag about DMAC enough and his leadership as president and all the collaborations and partnerships. So he's been a national leader for us, but clearly as a school and building partnerships is extraordinary. And the hundreds of people listening today think want to salute you. And there's a name that we know out there, Dr. Martha Cantor, who many consider just to be the guru in higher education. And clearly, President Obama knew that when he asked her to serve as the Under Secretary for Higher Education. So there is, Martha was truly a champion on college access, affordability, retention of growing college enrollment. So for that, even with the Pell Grants growing from 6 to 9 million students, Martha ran 6 White House initiatives, the student loan programs of up to $175 billion in this country, and she her undergraduate BA at Brandeis and her master's in education from Harvard University and her PhD in education from the University of San Francisco. She then went on to being the education consultant at New York University, at where she's really serving as a visiting professor of New York University. And just watch. You're going to see the innovation of core curriculum there, particularly around community colleges, that is about what Rob challenged all of us to be, boundary-breaking collaboration. So as Noah Brown at ACCT would say, and as Rob Denson would say, Martha Cantor, we salute you and your leadership for making certain that we are bound breaking in what we do with higher education. Martha Cantor?
Sure. Well, thank you so much, Edie. I'm very humbled by that kind of introduction, but I want to just start by saying that any achievements that the Obama administration made in the first term resulted from collaboration, partnerships, and relationships. And I'm recalling back in 2009, the first time I met Jane Oates, who's on the phone, who was my counterpart at the Department of Labor. And literally, for the last almost 5 years, we worked together on a regular basis. There probably wasn't a week or two that didn't go by that Jane or I weren't at the same table looking at industry needs and education needs in a collaborative way to figure out what do we do next. And it was very exciting as one of the accomplishments in the first term to have the Congress and then the President sign an appropriation to build capacity in two-year institutions that would level up to relationships with four-year universities and cement the pipeline of students in the years ahead. So I have to say that anything I can take credit for is because of the relationships that we've had at the federal level, and I know institutionally you have, many of you on the call, have those kinds of relationships, and if you don't, you need to pursue them. Because one of the things that we want to do with the STEM Connector Higher Education Council is lift up all the things you are doing, whether you're at a four-year research university, a community college, a state university, a proprietary institution. We are all doing innovative work that really doesn't get recognized in a holistic way. So what we want to know in the STEM Higher Education Council, and Rob and I and Edie and others have talked about this, is to figure out how to really profile what is working well and help institutions adopt, scale, replicate, and actually use the practices that all of you are engaged in that we may not know about, or we may have heard about something, but we haven't delved down into the infrastructure of those relationships, the infrastructure of what it takes to go from computer science to the jobs that are being filled in companies like Cisco or Intel or any number of the wonderful companies that have already stepped up to the plate to help the Higher Education Council. So one of the things we want to do is go across and up and down. And so vertically and horizontally, we want to connect universities with community colleges, with industry, with regional leaders, with national leaders and state leaders, because we know that not enough students are moving through the pipeline at the rate that industry needs and with the skills that industry wants. And there is some criticism, I might say, that is this all about money and industry and the economy? And for me, this is about the future of the country. This is about not only our economic prosperity, but our social prosperity. And like some of you, you may have been reading the book Capital in the 21st Century by Thomas Piketty. And if you don't have time to read this, you know, mega book, just read the first chapter. Because if we don't do these things, we will leave the middle class behind. And we cannot afford to do that. So we know in higher education today that even looking at the full-time students who have much more promise for success, if you look at the metrics, than part-time students, we know that one in every six full-time students is working full-time. That's amazing. We know I came from the community college sector. I saw, you know, two-thirds of my nursing students working full and part-time. So we have got to understand that the work students need to move through college has got to be deepened and better aligned with the instructional programs that they've signed up for. And we want to track their progress, and we want to understand how can internships and part-time and full-time jobs while students are getting educated be helpful to move students through the pipeline with students. So can't we make the work more relevant? Can we understand what it takes to build the confidence of industry and education to provide the internships, to give those students the jobs, and to actually have industry and education partners at the same table saying, these courses, this program of study, this aligned pathway, this accelerated pathway has led to the degrees and certificates that we need for our country to move forward economically and socially. So I'm very excited about the Higher Education Council. I think bringing people together, we've got expertise at the state level, the federal level, and certainly, you know, the campus leadership that's expressed here on the call this afternoon has got to be galvanized to really pump up those numbers and get more students moving through successfully to get the jobs that will be available going forward. So with that, I'm going to turn this back over to Ted. To Ted, and he will introduce the next speaker. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Martha. Great points, and certainly you cut to the essence of why we're doing this work. Just a note on the program flow for today. We thought it would be very interesting for our speakers to address some of the shared challenges that they are working to that cut across the entire higher education spectrum, both in the two-year schools, four-year schools, how this each institution that we and we don't have all schools today. Is we have some organizations that specialize in higher education, but how these schools are, these institutions are working to overcome these challenges. We have some very innovative stories. Our first speaker today is a longtime member in STEMconnector and has been very active in our innovation task force. Also has been a very active member overall in STEMconnector is Dr. Tim Welsh. From the Apollo Education Group, and he's Senior Vice President of Industry Strategy, where he leads a team to convert research-based industry insights into opportunities for educational innovations at Apollo Education Group institutions. Under Tim's leadership, the Industry Strategy Group builds effective coalitions to support and enhance a wide range of Apollo Industry Group functions, including curricular development, career services, diversity outreach, corporate engagement. Tim earned a Doctorate of Education degree from Harvard University, has his master's degree from University of Montana, and a bachelor's from Dickinson College, just up the road here in Pennsylvania. He's completed postgraduate studies in international affairs at Johns Hopkins School for Advanced International Studies in Bologna. Tim, I see that your microphone is on mute, so just make sure you unmute yourself before you join on. There you are. And just, you know, we'll turn it over to you, Tim. Thank you.
Great. Ted, thank you very much. And thanks also to Edie and the STEM Connector team for organizing this, and certainly a nod to our leader, Rob. When I was invited to join this conversation, I was asked if I'd spend a few minutes speaking about the value of a coalition like this from our perspective at the Apollo Education Group and University of Phoenix. And we are delighted, by the way, to have in our midst my colleague Jane Oates as a member of the Apollo group. The question of why a coalition like this is valuable was sort of hinted at in Rob's presentation. You heard three or four points emphasized by Rob several times. One was the need for boundary-breaking collaboration. Second was the range of capabilities represented by the institutions in the Higher Ed Council, in the STEM Higher Ed Council. Third was kind of a very nice characterization, I thought, by Rob, of the expectations of a group like this by employers, end users, if you will, of the job-ready talent that they hope we will produce. And finally, a standard that Rob sent, which is that we cannot disappoint employers and those who look to us to furnish them with career and job-ready talent. The value for us on the Apollo and University of Phoenix team of a coalition like this is really now in finding out if there are some ways that business principles or a business framework could be used to inform educational innovation in STEM. And again, as you heard from Rob, the range of capabilities here, what sort of comes to mind is a view of this group of institutions as essentially a supply chain that might be organized around collaborative planning, forecasting and replenishment. These are sort of standard frameworks that one hears about in the world of supply chain management and best practices. Collaborative planning really gets to the coalitions and the development of the talent there. Forecasting is all about demand management. And as Edie Fraser has noted on any number of occasions, a big part of the work of STEM Connector is really understanding the demand side for STEM education, both in terms of what it is and how good it could be, sort of a standard for innovation. And finally, replenishment, sort of a third common pillar of supply chain practices, implies certainly the development of solutions jointly by institutions such as ours in this group, and getting them to market. But it also implies replenishment, also the replenishment step also implies a requirement for innovation. As the landscape of careers in STEM changes and different areas of STEM take on greater priority than other, that will put a very helpful market pressure on the participating educational institutions to come forth with educational solutions, most often that will probably be a combination of content along the lines that Martha was just outlining. Some combination of content by institutions that have a shared interest in a common cause, in this case, the development of recurring innovation in STEM education nationally. So those are some of the principles that are really informing our work, I think, in the early stages here of the Higher Education Council. As you might imagine, right down the road after this, we'll be getting at some analytics, some ways of measuring what would count for effective collaboration by a group like this, what would count for innovation through some combined efforts around the pathways that Martha illuminated for us in her presentation. And we're very much looking forward to those next steps and certainly to our contribution to this whole effort. So, Ted, back over to you, and thanks very much.
Thanks, Tim. Very helpful, and I think you do a great job at articulating the value proposition for this group. We really appreciate the support of Apollo, and as the largest, one of the largest providers of education in the world. So thank you, Tim, and appreciate your leadership. I like this idea of recurring innovation, which is something that seems to be the holy grail. Our next speaker is actually joining me here in the room and is from a place that we all love and is really a leader of doing some amazing innovations in a city where it's pretty hard to keep up with innovation, but is doing an amazing job at leading his institution. It's Dr. Richard Rhodes, who's the president of Austin Community College. Dr. Rhodes is president and CEO of ACC District, where he joined in 2011, September, after serving as president of El Paso Community College for 10 years. A native of Alamogordo, New Mexico, Dr. Rhodes received his bachelor in business administration and accounting and his master's in arts in educational management and development from New Mexico State, wherein he earned his doctorate through the Community College Leadership Program at the University of Texas in Austin. The Community College Leadership Program honored Dr. Rhodes with his Distinguished Graduate Award in 2011. And I'm going to just switch the camera over to Dr. Rhodes now, and he's going to talk to you about the amazing things that they've got going on. So there you are, Dr. I'll change it so it says your name.
Okay. Good afternoon. And, you know, first of all, I want to thank Edie, and I want to thank Ted and STEM Connector for making this possible and giving us the opportunity to share. What I want to share this afternoon about are three promising ideas and perspectives that we have going on at Austin Community College. One has to do with competency-based education, a conversion of the curriculum and the delivery of the curriculum through competency-based. Another is creating a career expressway for our students to fast-track an accelerated pathway into careers. And third is talking about the reshaping of a mall into a college campus, into a mixed-use community, actually. And so we're going to get into that and how that links back to STEM fields. So if we could go to the first slide.
Sure.
Then this is our conversation. It's about reshaping and revitalizing a community. And through those three areas that I'm going to talk about specifically today, as you'll see on the next slide, that ACC was successful in collaborating with some other institutions around the country in receiving three DOL grants through TACT. All of those in some way that we worked on. A second grant that we have in collaboration with two community colleges in Western Governor University is competency-based computer programming training, and then the third has to do with biotechnology. And as you'll see on the next slide, that the ACC Healthcare, which is a credential to careers, really is involving creating a bioscience health professions academy. And within that academy, then our faculty are using what many of us are familiar with today in the STATway, which comes out of the Carnegie Foundation, for accelerated pathway and increased success in through mathematics into the health fields. And then taking a look at redesigning our versions of biology fundamentals, human anatomy, introduction to anatomy and physiology, and reconstructing those in a competency-based delivery module. And the use of technology to replace the traditional modes of instruction that we've historically used. And also giving our students access to a biosciences emporium, an open computer lab, plus science and technology project center, where they can receive on-demand assistance from tutors and faculty. And as you see on the next slide, then the next part of it is information technology. And that pilot, originally we were looking at having 40 students in the first pilot, which would have started last fall. we ended up with a large number of students who wanted to get into that, and so we ended up with a pilot cohort of 80 students. The basis of that was to do a competency conversion of our computer programming discipline, and that's going along very well. What it looks at is adult learners who will earn stackable lattice certificates, certifications, and associate degrees, as well as tracking a pathway to bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, through articulation agreements that we have with Western Governors University, who is a partner in that TAC grant. And as you'll see on the next slide, the other grant that we got has to do with biotechnology, and basically doing similar types of things, but looking at TAA-eligible workers and displaced workers to attain industry-recognized credentials in medical devices, biomanufacturing, and laboratory services. I'm going to transition over to the next piece on the next slide. That this was a study. You'll notice on the left-hand side of your screen, you'll see a product that was out of the University of Texas at Austin, the Ray Marshall Center. And this was taking a look at the market, the labor market in Central Texas. And what we found in that study that was sponsored by an organization in Austin, the Austin Area Regional Research Organization, they actually conducted this study through UT Austin. What we found is in Central Texas, we have somewhere in the neighborhood of 144,000 individuals who have entered the higher education arena at some point in time, but they never finished. They never finished a credential of any record. And so focusing on these students, potential students for the future, and the fact that not only have they not finished a credential, but many of those, most of those, actually are not earning a living wage for themselves and their family. So focusing on those, we got into partnership with ARRL, Austin Community College, Austin Interfaith, which is a broad-based grassroots faith-based social organization, as well as Capital Idea, which is a wraparound service provider, that together we're planning a career expressway for those individuals to get back on track and get a credential of record in two areas of interest, which is technology and health careers. I'm going to transition now, and it all fits together as to the delivery model, but the next slide you'll see is a picture of a campus, and this actually is the former Highland Mall, which was built in 1974 in Central Texas, in Austin, Texas. It was the first large indoor mall. It is a campus of 81 acres and approximately 1.2 million square feet. This, what you're seeing is the footprint for that. This was a large urban indoor mall, and it had gone into decline, creating a blighted community surrounding it. And so Austin Community College made the decision to purchase this mall in its entirety over a period of about 3 years it took to finish and finalize the purchasing. The plan for this is a large mixed-use community, of which you'll see retail space, you're going to see apartments, condominiums, but the centerpiece of all will be learning space. And as you see on the next slide, that we believe that this becomes the model for the nation. And I'm one of those people that likes to use acronyms, so we created a STEM acronym that this model for the future will be, number one, sustainable, it's going to be transit friendly, it is economically viable, and it is a mixed-use community delivered through education, and education is the centerpiece. As you see on the next slide, then we have the before and the after picture of the first renovation, which is the former JCPenney's. And you'll see on the top vision there is the Penney's as it was, which was much like a World War II bunker, in which no natural light could get through any space into that building. But you'll see on the bottom is what it will look like as we open it up this fall. It'll open up in August. So I call this picture Bunker to Brilliant, because that's actually what's going to be delivered there, is brilliance. And as you'll see on the next slide, this phase one of Highland Campus of Austin Community College, this building itself is 200,000 square feet. It has a capacity to serve 6,200 students. It will be the, I've got here, the nation's largest learning emporium, but I call it the galaxy's largest emporium, and we have named it the Accelerator, capital A, capital C for Austin Community College, Accelerator, so Accelerator, to accelerate individuals through competency-based delivery, through an emporium model for developmental education, for adult basic education, and for our competency-based programs that I just talked about earlier. Will all be housed in this emporium model. 604 seats. It is the galaxy's largest. It'll have other things such as library, student common areas, classroom space, laboratory space, and so forth. That will be the first and the grand opening of that new campus. And as you'll see on the next slide, and I'll conclude with this, we do have a vision for the 1.2 million square feet that is in that, that will create some innovative instruction space, what we call Creative Digital Media Center. It'll have a STEM center with simulation, state-of-the-art simulators for health career programs and IT. Also, looking at public-private partnerships that will help us bring kind of state-of-the-art, cutting-edge programs in technology specifically, giving us opportunities for incubators, for businesses to start up, hopefully outgrowth of our programs themselves, and then creating a regional workforce center that will coordinate and drive the workforce development of the future of Central Texas. And as I said, you know, tackling the developmental math problem that we have, that's going to take place right there in the Emporium with also flexible, innovative space that responds to the needs of business and industry in all the STEM fields. And I want to thank you for the opportunity to share with you today some of the exciting things that are going on in Austin, Texas at Austin Community College.
Thank you, Dr. Rhodes. Great job. I'm just going to flip the camera back over to me very quickly so I can introduce his colleagues that are here. Vic Villarreal, who is Vic, why don't you lean in and say hi. There he is.
Vice Chairman.
Good afternoon. Vic. Good afternoon. I'm the Vice Chair of Austin Community College. Very happy to be here. Thank you.
And Vic, and then we have Molly Beth Malcolm. Dr. Molly Beth Malcolm.
Hi, it's great to be here. Special Assistant to President Rhodes and over Government and External Affairs.
So we have an entourage, and just wanted to recognize that they had joined us as well. I'm going to turn to introduce our next speaker. I'm going to turn it over to our good friends Sheila and Dane Boyington, who are down in Chattanooga, who will be speaking a little bit later on the broadcast about Chattanooga State, but another Tennessee institution, which is Oak Ridge Associated Universities, is our next speaker. So Sheila, I'll turn it over to you to introduce Dr. Deanovatius.
Great. Thank you, Ted. And thank you so much for having us on the STEM Connector Town Hall. We're just really excited to be part of this innovation around higher education and hear from all these great institutions. So next, it's my pleasure to introduce a great friend of mine, actually on our Learning Blade board, but also a leader really in STEM education across the country, Dr. Deanovatius. Dean is the Vice President at Oak Ridge Associated Universities, which is a conglomeration of a lot of colleges throughout the campus. This is the great president, Dr. Jim Catanzaro, sitting next to me that I'll be introducing in a little bit. And Dean is up the road in Oak Ridge, where he serves as the vice president, as I said, for ORAL. Dean also was part of NSF and came to ORAL really to lead them on science education, STEM education, for what they're doing to influence students across not only Tennessee, but across the region, where the 100 and I think it's now 110 plus universities are part of what he is doing. And so we're just very excited to have him as part of the Higher Education Council. He does have a PhD in mathematics, true STEM person here, from Caltech, which is a great institution, really excited to have him as part of what we're doing, and I'm going to turn it over to Dean now to share a little bit more about undergraduate research and the influence of STEM within that. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Sheila. What a pleasant surprise and what a lovely introduction. I didn't know that was coming, so it's wonderful to see you. It's great to be here this afternoon, and I want to thank Ted and Edie also for the opportunity to join this council. I'm very pleased to be able to participate and to be able to talk to you about the rather spectacular rise of undergraduate education over the last 30 years. As Ted, are you queuing up the slides?
Got it right now, hang on.
Okay, thank you. In telling this story, there are really four primary themes that I'd like to address. And when we pull up the slides, you'll see what those themes are. And really, the talk is simply going to be an elaboration of these four fundamental themes.
It's just taking me a second to get the command up here, Dean.
That's all right. If I were a good whistler, I would just go ahead and do that. But
I'm not sure why it's not allowing us to. Here we go. That's why.
Didn't like something.
Yeah, I was in the wrong. Should be sharing. There it is. All right. Okay, we should be almost there. Okay, should be up now.
I don't know if you're seeing it. I'm still not, but all right. Well, I can just start talking.
Well, go ahead.
Okay. So the four points I really want to make around undergraduate research is the following. The first is that there have been fundamental changes in our attitudes about undergraduate research over those 30 years. It's really remarkable to think back on how just 30 years ago, undergraduate research was really perceived as something of an anomaly, and there was really no consensus that undergraduates could have a meaningful role in the research enterprise. That has fundamentally changed over the last 30 years. The second point is that undergraduate research has now been shown to have many important outcomes related to student learning. With the rise of undergraduate research, we're seeing an established research literature that is studying outcomes based around student learning that are very exciting. And that research is continuing, and it has important implications for the undergraduate curriculum. The third point is that the big trends that are driving the research enterprise overall in STEM disciplines, such as the rise of computation and the ascendancy of multidisciplinary research, are also having an impact at the undergraduate level. And lastly, the fourth point is that undergraduate research is now grown to the point where it's become a driver for changes in undergraduate education. So whether an undergraduate institution is directly involved in promoting undergraduate research, there are probably changes happening on their campus that are being driven by undergraduate research. Okay, so we said we still have no luck.
You're up. They're showing.
Oh, they are. Oh, okay. Somehow I maybe I'm the only one who can't see them.
Yeah, just click on my screen and you'll see what the viewers are seeing.
Yeah, somehow I'm just seeing a big SC
okay.
No slide.
Oh, okay. There might be something, but yeah, they're on the YouTube.
You can see. Okay. All right. So on the next slide, you'll see an example of how that attitude has changed over the last 30 years, and it's articulated by Joe Gallion of the University of Minnesota, who is one of the pioneers in advancing undergraduate research over the past three decades. Joe has made a tremendous impact, and you know, he talks very, very eloquently about the challenges he faced culturally in trying to promote undergraduate research in its infancy. But of course, today the landscape has changed a lot, and we don't hear so many people saying that undergraduate research is an oxymoron. So on the next slide, you'll see what the landscape for undergraduate research looked like back 30 years ago in the 1980s. And it was a very meager landscape. In 1981, the Council for Undergraduate Research was incorporated. And then for the first time, what we saw was a coalition that was advocating on a national basis for undergraduate research. And it was that early work that led to the development of the Research Experiences for Undergraduates program at the National Science Foundation in 1987. And in some respects, this is really the birth on the national scale of undergraduate research experiences as we commonly see them today. The professional society soon started joining in and started launching contributed paper sessions and research sessions for undergraduates on a very small scale. So for instance, the Mathematical Association of America in the 80s began with its first experimental session for undergraduates, and it got a grand total of 4 speakers. So very, very meager beginnings. Well, if you fast forward 30 years to today, on the next slide, you'll see how far we've come. The Council of Undergraduate Research now has tens of thousands of members and many hundreds of colleges and universities. And it's been joined by other coalitions that advocate for undergraduate research and promote it, such as the Higher Education Council and the work that STEMconnector is doing. So the CUR is not alone anymore. The NSFREU program has grown to where it supports about 8,000 undergraduates each year. And NSF overall is supporting about 30,000 undergraduates every year through its various programs. Undergraduate research at conferences is now a standard part of the presentations, and there are many of the major professional society conferences that have substantial turnouts of undergraduates. So that MAA, the Mathematical Association of America special session that started out with 4 speakers in the 1980s now has 200 poster presentations and 44 talks by undergraduates each year. If on the next slide, you'll see just how pervasive undergraduate research has become. In some majors like chemistry and environmental sciences, 3/4 of the undergraduates are now getting a research experience. And in other disciplines like mathematics and physics that have a strong theoretical component, the numbers aren't as high, but they're substantial and growing. Now, as the research piles up on the outcomes related to student learning, we're seeing some interesting findings. If you go to the next slide, you'll see that there are a number of positive outcomes now associated with participation in an undergraduate research experience. And some of them are the direct kinds of results and skills that you might expect from participating in the research process. They may be skills like analyzing data, or learning lab techniques, or the integration of theory and practice. But what's perhaps more interesting is the indirect impacts on student learning and student attitudes about education, things about persistence and the ability to work through obstacles and the ability to work independently are now being seen as direct attributes associated with participating in an undergraduate research experience. And I think we're going to see more and more work like this that shows that the benefits of undergraduate research are so widespread that it will become increasingly the norm for undergraduates to have this kind of experience. Now, if you go to the next slide, we can talk briefly about some of those trends that are driving the research enterprise as a whole, but also undergraduate research in particular. And the first is the rise of multidisciplinary training. You know, we are now, in a broad way, moving towards problem-inspired education that involves boundary-spanning work at the interface of research and practice. We're seeing interdisciplinary teams tackling very, very challenging problems that cannot be solved within the boundaries of a single discipline. And this is, of course, started transforming the way faculty members and senior people have done research, but it's now trickling down through the graduate schools and now even into the undergraduate research experience. On the next slide, you'll see the impact of the rising role of computation. This has been one of the most dramatic changes over the last 30 years. Computational capability is increasing so quickly that we are now reaching, as we are on the verge of exascale computing, we're now reaching a tipping point between descriptive and predictive modeling on many important problems. And that has created a very exciting research landscape for people who have deep skills in computer science. Now, the rise in computation has also created opportunities for undergraduates to participate in research because a lot of these undergraduates are incredibly comfortable around computers. In many cases, they're more comfortable than their senior colleagues. And so it's very exciting to see the contributions that young people can make to the research enterprise in this age of computers. My last point, and that's on my last slide, is that all of this is actually having very interesting impacts on undergraduate education. It is not just about research. Research and education are inextricably linked. That's been the case at the graduate level for some time now, but is now becoming the case at the undergraduate level. And the drivers of interdisciplinary training and computation are also contributing to the changes at the undergraduate curriculum. College deans and department heads are increasing their demands for providing research experiences for undergraduates. As these experiences become the norm, they change the landscape for admission to graduate schools and for high-tech jobs. Whereas at one time, a research experience at the undergraduate level was not a prerequisite for admission to graduate school in sciences, it increasingly is. And that's going to change the way we all educate our undergraduates, because we want them to be prepared to have those opportunities at the graduate level. So in wrapping up, and where do I see opportunities in all of this for the Higher Education Council and all of us who would like to partner on these challenges, it's that we all have the opportunity, one, to be strong advocates for research experiences for undergraduates. We saw that advocacy was key to founding the NSF REU program that really launched undergraduate education at the national level. And we also have a role to play in not only disseminating but driving knowledge and innovation with regards to undergraduate research. And I think that's a great place for us to be. So thank you, Ted.
Dean, thank you very much. That very interesting presentation, and I think you gave us some great data points. Just a note, because we've had three beautiful presentations so far, and there will be more. The slides will be available on our website. I'm looking at my colleague Brian. We'll get them up there tomorrow, you think?
Yeah,
we should have them, and we'll make them available in PDF so that you don't get a million megabyte thing. I think one point I just wanted to add on, because you did such a great job, Dean, of covering the field, could you just talk, I know you're muted right now, could you just talk a little bit about how ORAO is helping schools facilitate undergraduate research opportunities.
Sure, Ted. I'm happy to do that. So what we do at ORU is we try to provide linkages and partnerships between universities and colleges and community colleges with partners in the federal sector, the national labs, federal agencies such as NSF, the NIH, the Environmental Protection Agency, all of the big funders of science at the federal level in this country through internship programs in the summer and during the academic year. And so it's a very large portfolio. Right now it covers about 8,000 participants annually across 240 different locations. So we have an exciting role to play, and we're very much interested in designing programs in partnership with both colleges and universities, the industrial sector, and federal partners as well.
Thank you very much, Dean. That was just helpful. I think that you guys are a critical actor in the higher education space, particularly as you discuss the critical importance of research in improving outcomes in higher education. So I appreciate you just taking a moment to go through that. To introduce our next speaker, it looks like I'm still Richard Rhodes on our tagline. I'm Ted Wells, not Richard Rhodes. I'm going to turn it over to our to introduce our next speaker to address a very important issue that is important to us at STEMconnector and has been a very important focus of the last few years is how do we get more women into STEM fields? Women participated about half the rate of their male counterparts. Later on, we will be hearing about how do we engage underrepresented minorities. But right now, I'd like to turn it back to Edie, who can introduce our next speaker from Arizona State. Okay, I think you're on, Edie.
Just with great respect, it's introducing Dr. Mitzi Montoya, Vice President and University Dean for Entrepreneurship and Innovation, again, Arizona State University. And let's just first talk about Mitzi herself, because she's not only Vice President and Dean and is the guru that we see on innovation between technology and entrepreneurship, but she's also a professor of management department of the Carey School of Business. She's been on the board of the Center for Entrepreneurship, and again, we just have to say 7 out of every 10 jobs are entrepreneurship, not necessarily Fortune 500. So Dr. Montoya received her PhD in marketing and statistics, right? Great combination. And a BS in applied engineering studies from Michigan State University. So we just have to also brag about Mitzi, because she's been engaged with us at STEMconnector for more than 2 years as a real thought leader. She's a vice chairman of our STEM Innovation Task Force. She's been kicking us to lead on innovation excellence along with our chair of our innovation task force. Hi. And as we then turn to women and girls and our future, she's been very active in now advancing our Million Women Mentors as a champion and supporter, as has the Apollo Education Group and others. But Mitzi stands tall as being a role model for this nation in terms of women and girls for the future. Dr. Mitzi Montoya.
You're live.
Thank you, Edie. And let me know when you have the PowerPoints up, Ted. I still have not been able to see them, but I will go forward on mine. Edie, it's always hard to follow an introduction from you. You are too generous, and we stand tall together at about 5 feet tall. So, so thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be here and hear the great ideas from the others that have been speaking. And I think, to me, that is the real value add of the opportunity to be a part of this coalition, is the learning that we're able to share with each other on important topics, including the last one that Dean just spoke about regarding undergraduate research, which is something that we at Arizona State are working hard to advance. Today I want to talk about a couple of topics. One is women in STEM, and then the second being opening the doors of the university as part of our responsibility to help develop the K-12 pipeline. So Ted, if you'd go to the next slide. These are some statistics that many of you are familiar with, both from Department of Commerce, National Science Foundation, and National Academy Studies, and then from some organizations that are respected organizations like the Girl Scouts and Girls Who Code recently did this last study. And these figures are, of course, appalling to many of us, and it is a great concern. I actually happen to be at a conference today talking about entrepreneurship and women's representation in entrepreneurship, which is equally underrepresented and look very much like the parallels that we see in numbers for STEM. And so clearly we have work to do, and I think that one of the things that is the advantage from my perspective of being part of this coalition is that it is an opportunity to learn from great leaders who have had success and at their universities and their communities, at the high school level and the community colleges, and work to really do the thousand flowers bloom approach to how do we try to address this challenge, which we know to be a sociocultural challenge, and not just something of a matter of launching more and more programs. So these are issues that go back to the youngest of ages, and we need to engage families and we need to engage our communities. So if you go to the next slide, the reality is that we are making progress and there is steady incline, but we of course still have challenges. And this is a statistic for underrepresented minorities, which includes women, and I know we have additional speakers that will focus more specifically on particular sectors, but my learning over the years is that this is an issue that requires breaking this down segment by segment, sector by sector, and in fact not looking at any of the underrepresented groups as undifferentiated masses, because they're not. And ways that we've made progress have to do with providing, instead of expecting these underrepresented groups to conform to us, but instead conforming to and learning from what their needs are, and understanding that we need to make sure that our programs and our processes meet their needs. And I would say this has probably been the source of much of our innovation over the last few years. So next slide. Some of the things then that we have focused on, and I'm going to give you some examples in the next few slides of ways that we're trying to open the doors to the university with a primary focus on fostering creativity and inspiring young people and young women in particular and other underrepresented groups to consider the STEM fields. And I want to focus on some of those examples because we've seen good return from that. But just a caution that has come out even as I was here today talking about entrepreneurship is that language and imagery matter. There has now been enough research that I think that the body of evidence is clear that how we talk about things and the fact that engineering is perceived as a gendered role is something that we need to be aware of and make an effort to improve on how we recruit, so our recruiting practices and also our practices in the classroom. And then I'm talking all the way back through the K-12 pipeline and also once we have students at in one of our higher education institutions. The language and imagery is incredibly important. And likewise, this notion that one of the reasons that we focus very heavily on project-based learning, particularly in the STEM field and application, is that that hands-on experience helps build competence, which in turn builds confidence, which in turn breeds resilience, which among young women, as we have looked at the studies over the years, are some of the feelings why and the attitudes and reasons why people have self-described why they have opted out of the STEM disciplines and why they don't necessarily stick with a STEM field, even if they have degrees in it. So the degree to which we're able to model this practice through projects and through application, we are providing all young people a leg up and their interest in and persistence in STEM fields, but most especially young women. I'm going to give you a few examples. Next slide. The one, so just give you some different examples that I think all universities, all community colleges in their respective regions, and these are things that we've learned from others and things that we are now actively working to implement in our own region, is we're very actively networking and finding ways to open the doors to the university to not just talk about and communicate what STEM is, but engage people in what we do and what research means and what the different STEM fields mean. And so we have actively partnered with a network of science museums, and I mentioned a couple of here in terms of things that we're doing. We have a strategic alliance with the Arizona Science Center, and we are working with them to make sure that we have minor and major exhibits in the Science Center where hundreds of thousands of students pass through, particularly in the junior high, middle school range, every single year. And the degree to which we make those things hands-on and interactive exhibits, the more young minds we touch and the potential we have for engaging them in their interest in STEM. Libraries. Public libraries are a trusted location in local communities. They serve micro communities. We have historically not particularly interacted with them as partners. We have launched what's called our Alexandria co-working network. And the idea is through that network, we are sending out representatives, ambassadors, and extending some of our projects into the networks for teachers, families, students to take part of and to activate the community around us and engage with the community where they are rather than assuming that they will make their way into the university. Next slide. A new project that we just launched this year is focused around citizen science and citizen engagement. And this is a major initiative for us related to the prior 2 points to create access points to our research and likewise enable and benefit our faculty who are interested in and pursuing citizen-based research and citizen-engaged research to put those two things together in a win-win. So the idea is we're creating access to projects that enable a variety of participants to participate in research. Our focus is K-12 and K-12 teachers, but it's open to the general public, where citizens can participate in data collection, data analysis, data interpretation. And the topic today is STEM-focused, but we actually include the whole scope of university research in this effort. This was an open RFP internal to the university. Faculty were selected from across the university, including humanities, to participate in this. And then those projects are what are placed out in the museums and the libraries. Just to give one example, one includes the collection of water use data that is feeding into a larger research project on water sustainability in Arizona. And it is a very interesting both online and at-home data collection project that has environmental science curriculum wrapped around it for a high school teacher that might be interested in using it that way. But just an individual student can participate on their own. And it is represented in the science centers and a couple of the libraries. This is just one example. And the other are innovation challenges. These are challenges defined by each academic unit that are open to the public as well as, of course, university-wide. And I give one example here, which was the green electronics challenge, green electronics waste challenge. So that is, what could we do with electronic waste other than landfilling it? It was the example here, and this was sponsored by our School of Sustainability and Fulton School of Engineering. And it was in partnership with university in China, Tsinghua University, and sponsored by TechShop and Instructables.com. And it drew up applications and competitions from all over the world. It was available and open to anyone 13 years and older. And there are obvious benefits to the university in this, but the idea is, again, to inspire and engage young people with purposeful outreach to organizations that serve young women, like the Girl Scouts, to give another example. And to encourage them to participate. And then last slide, we have actively been working on developing programs that are train the trainer programs to focus on high school educators and students. We have launched Makers and Innovators Clubs. This summer we're hosting an Innovation Through Design Thinking program. In fact, that partnership with Verizon came about as a result of STEMconnector. putting a company and their interests together with the university and our ability to do continuing education for teachers, but to really help high school educators learn principles behind teaching innovation and applied project methodologies, again with the goal of inspiring students to pursue STEM disciplines. So these are just a few ideas, and for us the benefit of this council has been learning examples and exciting programs from other universities that we can implement and work to extend as we work to make a difference in all of our communities together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mitzi. That was a great presentation. Thank you. Mitzi has been very active, as Edie said, in a number of our initiatives, including the STEM Innovation Task Force, and really a terrific champion for a number of the most important things that are out there facing the STEM world today. I'm trying to get myself back on here. Let's see. Did that work? There we go. And I'm looking to see if our next speaker was able to join. Mitzi, thank you very much, and good luck with your conference. Okay, I'm looking. Do I see Chad on here? I do not. So I'm going to give... We have one of our speakers was supposed to be in the facility and in our conference room from Chad Womack from UNCF, but appears to be... He had something come up at the last minute. So I'm going to move along to Vin Mano. Vin, are you ready? If I introduce you now, let me. He's actually hidden, so I need to. Vin, okay. I think you're muted. If you could unmute.
I just unmuted myself.
You are perfect. Great. Okay. Well, let me brag about you for a second, and we are thrilled to have Olin College in Massachusetts as a partner of STEM Connectors, and our speaker today is the Provost and Dean of Faculty at Olin College of Engineering. Vin's colleague Michelle Davis spoke about Olin at our last STEM Council's meeting, and I was frankly just blown away by the quality of instruction and just the dedication to innovation that Olin has taken in such a short time, with obviously considerable resources, but there's a huge amount of stewardship on the part of Olin College to disseminate, and actually one of the beneficiaries of some of that knowledge was Arizona State. I know that Mitzi, when they were setting up the College of Innovation Technology, leaned on some of the work that Olin had done. So Dr. Vin Mano joined the Olin College of Engineering as Provost and Dean of Faculty in July 2011. Prior to joining Olin, Dr. Mano was Associate Provost and Professor of Mechanical Engineering at Tufts University in Medford, Mass. He continues to hold an adjunct faculty appointment at Tufts. There, he also held appointments as Department Chair of the Mechanical Engineering Department, Associate Dean of Engineering, and Dean of Engineering ad interim. He's worked as an internship engineer in the private sector and as a U.S. Navy summer, let me make sure I'm with you, summer senior summary faculty fellow. His expertise is computational thermal fluid dynamics. I don't know what that is, Vin, but it's really impressive, and including applications in power generation, electronics, thermal energy management, and manufacturing process. He has authored or co-authored more than 140 journal articles, conference proceedings papers, and technical reports. He holds a U.S. patent and is technical reviewer for several technical journals and government agencies. He serves on the board of directors of the American Society of Engineering Education's Research Council, Engineering Research Council, as well as its Engineering Dean's Institute. So we're honored to have you on, Vin, and I look forward to your presentation. Do you have slides, correct?
Yes, I do. It would be great if you could bring them up, please, Ted.
You got it. Okay. You're on screen.
Okay. Well, as Ted brings up the slide for me, it's really terrific to join the conversation, and the organizers could not have done a better job of putting the last two presentations and mine together, because I think we're going to hear many of the many complementary themes, that of pipeline, gender. In particular, I was struck with Dean's presentation about the importance of undergraduate research. So in many ways, the slides that hopefully Ted will bring up soon will speak to what I would say is the is a complementary aspect of education. I think the slides are coming up now.
You should be up.
And There, thanks very much. So we've talked a lot about the empowerment of research and different types of programmatic activities. I'd like to complement that by looking through a little bit of a narrow lens with engineering and changing engineering education because the curriculum or the curricular experiences of students are still a major factor in the undergraduate education space. What I'd like to focus on is the empowerment of a learning environment focused on doing then learning as opposed to just-in-case learning. So if you can go to slide 2, please. And to step out a little bit of a distance, to talk about what are the liberating potential of changing undergraduate engineering education, and I should say as a footnote that I think much of this does transform to other STEM fields and education in general, though I will talk about some particular aspects that I think are engineering-centric. One of the hidden, the hidden facts that we all deal with is the fact that even though there are pipeline issues of the number of people that enter STEM, and particularly engineering, we lose a number of engineering students who have decided to come to engineering school. We lose them fairly early in the program. And the process that we are searching for is to change their early learning experiences to really enforce their own motivations and to have them develop their own narratives as to why they want to have this identity. At the same time, if we do so, we really redefine what the opportunity landscape is for the pre-college population in general, for those people who have not thought about engineering as a formative undergraduate educational experience. On the other end of the process, we want to engage in a learning system that produces that produces what I would call innovators in training for society. People who are appropriate and are motivated to tackle the grand challenges of our own times rather than create more challenges. One of the things that motivates me, and I'm sure many of you, and to a certain extent is a bit frustrating, is that this is not a new challenge. And if you go to the next slide, three, please. Here's a picture of Washington Roebling, who some of you probably knew already, was the chief engineer of the Brooklyn Bridge. And he went to engineering school more than 150 years ago. He went to a fabulous engineering school, Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, which is was a great school then and is a great school now. And in David McCullough's book on the building of the Great Bridge, he quotes from the Journal of Washington Roebling, who reflected on his early education as a young engineer, that he was frustrated by the terrible treadmill of forcing an avalanche of figures and facts into young brains, not qualified to assimilate them. I am still busy trying to forget the heterogeneous mass of unusable knowledge that I could only memorize. It's amazing that we could probably lift that quote and put it into the several reports of the National Academy of Engineering over the last 10 to 20 years. So we have more than enough motivation. Next slide, please. The goal of changing the learning and the curricular experience for undergraduate engineering is to move away from the thought that that engineering is.
Ask Ted if he sees me.
Hang on, Vin. I think I've got chat on, and I just want to mute him.
Cool.
Apologize.
No problems.
If people join, they're still not hidden. So you're back.
I'm back. Okay. It's still loading on my screen, and I'm waiting. Okay. That the idea that engineering is just is not a body of knowledge per se. What it is a process, and it's an exciting process, and that's what should motivate people. If you want to start on this circular path that I have on this slide, The motivation is anybody looking at a situation or something that doesn't even exist and saying there must be a better way. And that transfers to trying to think about what that better way might be. What's the idea? Why can't we do it here? And this is where knowledge comes in. What can we do? What can't we do? What violates physical laws? Which physical laws have not been exploited? And then if you find a path for exploitation, to not fixate on the details, but to try it, to prototype it. That's where the fun is. That's where the exploration is. That's where the learning is. Very much that's the same motivation in the research environment. Often you will find that your wonderful idea did not work properly, or perhaps did not work at all through testing. And that's where your ability to analyze and do critical thinking comes in, to think about, well, let's continue that. There must be a better way. At the same time, the excitement of this process is that there are other constraints that are important that are running around this loop with you. There's the clock is ticking. You can't take forever to do it. You're dealing with resources, financial and otherwise, and you're trying to understand what the implications of this circular path is in a societal context. This is a much broader picture of what an engineering career might be. Next slide, please. So the underlying point is that process trumps content, especially, I'd say, in early foundational experiences and in our experience over the last 10 years, where basically we all know what Google knows. But what Google knowing everything has introduced to us is this poor, confused child on the right on the screen that says, the more I think, the more confused I get. And it's really to understand how to learn and how to navigate this system of information in a useful way. And I'm not going to read it, but certainly one of the pillars of this movement is was Charles Vest, who unfortunately recently passed away, who was president of the National Academy of Engineering and the past president of MIT. Next slide, please. Just for those of you who don't know about Olin College, I'll just give us a quick snapshot, not read through this entire slide, but just for a little bit of context, that Olin is a small school, small private school, founded not long ago. Our oldest alumni are going to turning 30 this year. It's basically as a school, which is a laboratory for engineering education innovation. And because of its size, it really has a dual mission, that not only to be the laboratory, but also to work with others through collaboration and co-creation to catalyze that change throughout engineering education and hopefully education in general. Some things of the six bullets on this slide, the three that I would like to highlight is one, in concert with what Mitzi was saying, we strive to have a gender balance in our students and our faculty. We also have no academic departments. The curriculum program, we strive to have it a coherent whole, and we try to do so in a framework of continuous innovation, especially based on culture. Next slide, please. The structure of our pedagogy, and I also want to say at this point that we are, as all education, is very much a work in progress, and there are lots of bumps and jolts along the way, but the pedagogical spine of our education is, of course, to have solid technical courses and skills, but really pay a lot of attention to design and entrepreneurship as competencies, not as outcome, but as competencies, that our students will have the experience of having a design thinking philosophy and the idea of using resources in an entrepreneurial way along with the analysis tools that they need. So this slide, the picture into what is engineering, tries to illustrate that, in that one way of opening up this door of change is to widen that gap of saying, well, engineering is about feasibility. It's about specification leading to prototype. Really, you should take an expanded view of that, that really it's a people to people. Somehow those specifications come from problems and needs, and once you create those prototypes, they will successful or fail depending on the marketplace, so that your curricular structure should reflect that. Next slide, please. So it's a multi-dimensional learning experience. It's one where throughout the curriculum we try to pay careful attention to team and team works, how teams work and how they don't work, what are the roles that people have in teams. Obviously, communication is terribly important, as is multiple intelligences. One approach that we try to take, and in all honesty, again, this is a trial and error approach often, is to provide for students the autonomy to have what I would call survivable failures. Failures where they can be learning experiences, so a failure in experience is not a failure in a course. A failure in experience is not transmitting the message that people are not up to the task or not able to be good engineers, or at least to use an engineering background to achieve what they would like. And the pictures that I'm showing you on this slide are different facets of our students in different parts of the curriculum trying to emphasize this point. Next slide, please. So on the last two slides, I'd like to make this connection to the whole STEMconnector experience, that just as in a research experience, such as described through the Oak Ridge presentation, where being engaged in a high quality and genuine research program is an important aspect of the undergraduate research experience, that partnerships, and especially partnerships based on real problems, is important to experience-based learning. First of all, it provides to the students a tangible validity to their practice-based experiences. They see it as real. The second, from more of a systemic standpoint, is that these sorts of partnerships lead to interactions among the partners that are partnerships rather than transactional. That it's more about ecosystem than it is pipeline, that it is joining hands to do things together. The third point is that through these experiences and through the impact that industry and the other non-academic sectors can have in the enterprise, is that this idea that engineering is a process, this idea that content is not king, is something that industry can actually drive through its recruiting practices and through its own advocacy. And that will in turn increase the awareness of the public and political leaders that, again, we will get past what I hope is a tipping point in a paradigm shift. Next slide, please. So to speak specifically about why Olin sees memberships in organizations such as the STEMconnector Higher Ed Council as being important, as something I think we all share. From an atmospheric standpoint, we connect all the important stakeholders in this enterprise. But more than connect the stakeholders, I think we all have a shared agenda, but specific roles in those agenda. Those of us in academia have to develop, as in focusing on the curriculum, develop appropriate curricular and supercurricular structures, but not only that, reward systems for students and faculty that reinforce these messages. That this is not, people are not commodities, people are not consumables, that it is up for industry and where our students go next to assume responsibility, to share responsibility for formative education. There is certainly a governmental role. Resources are always scarce, and we can advocate for evidence-based resource allocation and also use its own bully pulpit to convince the society of the urgency of this work, and to call out one group that we don't talk about much, creditors who could think about systems that insist on true competencies and professional demarcations as a way of also helping drive change. And with that, I will conclude and thank everybody for their attention.
Thank you very much, Vin. That's a great presentation. And let me unshare my screen. Okay, there we go. You know, I like that part at the end where you bring together the importance of academy, industry, government, and accreditors. And it's interesting, the last group, the accreditors that you were mentioning, have come up repeatedly in conversations as a group that, you know, based on just the, you know, I think you talked about it was Dean who mentioned the computational capability and just the ability to do things in ways that we never did in the past, just based on how rapidly technology is changing. One of the groups we work with is food and agriculture, and you know, it's being dominated by big data. And so really being able to develop, you know, to inform the academy model and also through industry and government support that we need a new paradigm of looking at higher education. So very great remarks. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Moving on now, and just a gentle reminder, we are running a little short on time for our next two speakers, and I apologize for not moving everything along. Our next speaker is a wonderful woman that I had the opportunity to meet out in Claremont, California, earlier this summer at a conference. And Dr. Dina Maloney is the superintendent and president of Taft College, which is located, I guess, about 45 minutes west of Bakersfield. Is that correct?
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. So Dr. Maloney began her education career in California as the director of contract education at Santa Clarita Community College District. In 2001, Dr. Maloney became Dean of Economic Development at College of the Canyons. Since then, she was named founding dean of Canyon County Campus, a startup campus which quickly grew to over 5,000 students, and later was named vice president and assistant superintendent in the Santa Clarita Community College District, before becoming superintendent and president of Taft College in 2012. Dina, I will turn it over to you and look forward to your remarks.
Very good. Thank you so much. It's really my pleasure to be part of this town hall meeting, and I really want to express my appreciation to Ted and to Edie and to Dr. Denson for putting this all together. Now, I do have a presentation which I think you're going to be loading in just a moment, but let me just start by talking a little bit about Taft College just to give you some context. We are a small community college in Kern County, California, in the Central Valley. We are a somewhat rural community college. There is nothing between us and the major city closest to us, which is Bakersfield, California, except oil fields and almond groves. So agriculture and ag are very important sectors in the Kern County economy, and the college actually sits right in the middle of the Midway Sunset oil field. So I'd like to share with you a little bit about why we looked to federal funding to help us launch our STEM initiative. And the first slide that I'd like to highlight, if you would please go to slide 2, is the picture that I want to paint for you in terms of our economy here in Kern County. In our region, the major industry sectors are agriculture and energy, primarily petroleum and natural gas drilling, but also you can see that healthcare is an important energy sector in Kern County. Kern County unfortunately suffers from a unemployment rate higher than the statewide average, and our college going rate is lower than we'd like to see it. So we have some challenges. These industry sectors that are predominant in Kern County really are framed within the STEM space, if you will, and the employers in our area really need a talent pool of STEM prepared workers to enter very, very positive career opportunities in their industries. The next slide will illustrate the other side of the coin, kind of The first slide was the demand side of the equation. This next slide is the supply side of the equation for us at Taft College. And you'll see in the next slide the challenge we face with the underpreparedness of our students. The overwhelming majority of incoming students at Taft College test below what we consider transfer level courses. And you can see the percentages in our basic skills placement rates for English and math are 90 and 98% for spring of 2013. That is a real challenge when you're in an economy that is dependent upon people armed with the right skill sets in STEM, in the STEM disciplines, and your incoming freshmen and your returning workforce that's coming back to the college are testing at such a below college level rate. So for us, the first challenge was in our STEM initiative, what do we do to prepare students? The college is prepared for STEM, but our students are not. And so we launched our first initiative. If you go to the next slide, I'll describe it, which is a federal grant that supported what we're calling our Quest for Success project. This is a Title V HSO solo grant. We're in year four out of a five-year grant, and it's really designed to prepare and accelerate basic students as they go through their developmental sequence so that they can reach transfer level courses in a fairly condensed period of time, be able to take on transfer level work and complete and transfer in STEM and other fields and be able to be successful as college students. And this is a really important first foundational step for us in our STEM initiative, was to address the issues with our underprepared students that wanted to enter STEM fields but were not at a level in math and English to be able to do so and be successful. If you go to the next slide, I want to talk a little bit more about this foundational grant because it's so important in positioning the college to move forward in its STEM initiative. So our students in our Quest for Success program go through four basic phases of their experiences with us. There's a welcome phase, there's a what we call the stay phase, where they're enrolled in their basic skills courses and are supported by counseling, educational advisor. There's an improve and succeed phase with tutoring and learning support services, advisement, workshops, and peer mentoring. And then they transition into their transfer level courses. And we are very pleased with the outcomes we're receiving and seeing in our efforts in these four phases as our students progress and are able to move forward and get to a transfer level course in math and English and the rest of their programs so that they can then successfully transfer. Following the implementation of the Quest for Success grant, we launched a Pathways project, which is described on the next slide. And the Pathways project is also a federally funded HSI Title V co-op grant, which is designed to help create a model pathway for STEM degree completion. There is a research-based element on this, and this is a co-op grant with the University of Laverne. So I want to mention that this does tie back to some of the comments made by other speakers about the importance of research and the undergraduate education. We partnered with Laverne on this grant. We are going to be providing students the opportunity to go to the University of Laverne in a summer program and be able to do research as part of that experience. I think some of the experiences that these students will have will really benefit them as they move forward in their undergraduate education. But we're also planning to benefit as a college because when these students come back, they're going to be working as peer mentors to those that have not gone through this experience as part of our learning support. The Pathways grant really has a focus both in the looking behind at the K-12 feeder pipeline as well as moving forward into articulation with four-year universities. So we're doing a lot with Pathways to increase STEM awareness and preparing K-12 students in generating and engaging them in an interest in STEM. And we are also working on faculty development and curriculum reform at the college so that we can better prepare students in the STEM fields. We're really trying to close the curriculum gaps and articulate our programs both from feeder schools and to the universities in which our students transfer. The next slide describes our SEED grant, which is another federally funded HSI Title V grant. And so if you can move to that slide, you'll see that our SEED grant really does focus specifically on STEM in the engineering realm. With this source of funds, we're able to start a pre-engineering program. We are working to develop an engineering outreach program with high schools in our area to help students develop an interest in and awareness of engineering and create a robust stream of students that wish to enter this field. This also includes developing a pathway so that our students can transfer to Cal State University Bakersfield, which is, as you mentioned in my introduction, that's about 45 minutes away. And this will really, I think, help our students in their quest to become engineers. We're focusing on both the academic side of things and the preparation, but also on the student psychology of it in helping them understand and why they want to be engineers and see themselves in that role and be able to handle the affective domain as well as their academic preparation. Sorry. The next slide deals with the phases the student experiences in our Pathways and SEED grants. Rather than the QFS grant with four phases, Pathways and SEED has three different components: a welcome that involves community outreach and engagement even before students are college students with us, and helping to articulate our programs and make sure that students entering are college ready by working with our high school partners. The student experience is both the academic programs of faculty support, the learning support through tutoring and supplemental instruction that helps them get to their transfer and career readiness, either to transfer to a four-year school, enter employment with a two-year degree, or a certificate and an associate degree. If you go to the next slide, you'll see some basic components that we have designed into our program and the activities that we have in place right now. In terms of community outreach, we're doing a lot with our K through 12 schools in the area. We recently held what we called a STEMvitational. We had 200 high school students come and participate in activities with our math and science faculty. And I have to tell you that the energy in the room was so exciting to see these students see themselves as having a place here at the college and meeting with our faculty that can help them in reaching their academic goals. We have, like many other schools, a Young Innovators Club for our high school students. We offer summer camps with our local elementary and high school and junior high students. We, through a prior grant, developed a mobile learning lab, which we take out to various schools in our area. It's outfitted with all kinds of technology, and students and their teachers can come into the lab and get exposure to STEM disciplines. We're working on dual enrollment and a whole variety of other things to encourage that interest and engagement from our the younger students in our community. In our support services, we offer counseling, of course, and educational advising, but we're doing things that help promote awareness of STEM. We recently did what we called a PI Week on campus, which involved our science and math faculty and our college students in a variety of learning activities that was very, very successful. I already mentioned we're developing an engineering degree program, and we have our STEM-related degrees and courses. We offer an energy technology program that's in its fourth year that prepares students for two-year degree prepared positions in the petroleum and natural gas industry. We're developing new classrooms and other supportive elements we need to be able to offer our academic programs in the STEM fields. And then, of course, we have our four-year college and industry partnerships, which are robust and working well in helping to support making sure our programs reflect what the needs of the industry are and what our students' interests are, and connecting those with programs throughout our community. The next slide describes some of our future ideas that we have in terms of these four components, and we want to take this to the next level. We're offering a mad science camp, which is kind of a fun thing for our students. We're doing a math jam, which I think is very innovative this summer. Let me describe just a little bit about that. The math jam is a week-long program. When students and potential students enter the college, they take a math placement test. And those that place below our college level or transfer level math and enter a developmental math sequence are looking at adding semesters onto their journey through the community college into transfer. So the math jam is a week-long event. Once students take their placement test, they can participate in math jam, and with 1 week of preparation and review, retake that math placement test, and many will find that they can jump a level or two in that developmental math sequence and accelerate their pathway through the community college and not look at semester after semester of developmental math. We're very excited about that. We also have some other ideas in terms of our research camp with the University of Laverne and our summer project, and then using the students that participate in that research camp as peer mentors. And we're very excited and can't wait to see what the outcomes are regarding that. I want to close with just a little summary of how the federal grants have helped our college really start a process of transformation in really rethinking and restructuring how we address the needs of our students in basic skills and how we prepare them for STEM transfer courses. We are truly undergoing a transformation in how our faculty and our curriculum support student success and how we work with our industry partners and our four-year institutions to ensure that students can have a clear pathway for entering our college, working through their STEM coursework, and successfully transferring or graduating. In the same manner, working with our feeder institutions to develop and engage students in an interest in STEM so that when they enter our institution, they're already focused and ready to go. We're really excited about how these federal grants have helped us to undertake this process of transformation, infuse energy and excitement on the campus around STEM, and be able to move forward in advancing STEM for our students and for our institution as a whole. And on that note, I think that our participation in the STEM Connector is absolutely essential because it's going to help us get connected with other institutions that are doing exciting and innovative things. Particularly being a small school, we don't have the capacity and the resources to be able to reinvent the wheel. We want to learn from others. We really want to make sure that we're maximizing the connections that we're going to build through this organization. We're very excited to be part of it, and I really thank you for the opportunity to be part of this seminar today.
Dina, thank you very much. Apologies at the beginning. Your slides, it's a very complicated procedure to get them to share. So if you missed, for viewers out there, if you missed the first couple, they are available online. Thank you, Dina. I'm going to move right on to our next speaker because I know that he has a pressing appointment coming up next. So I'm going to bring it back to Sheila Boynton. And she's going to introduce Dr. Catanzaro from Chattanooga State. You guys are muted. Just make sure that you're unmuting your microphone. There you go.
Are we unmuted? Okay, great. So thank you so much, Ted, and great presentation.
And Sheila, just project your voice because the mic is kind of far away.
Okay. Yeah, maybe this is better. I'll try to hold this mic. So thank you so much for this great job on this STEM innovation higher ed presentation. I think now you're really in for a treat. We've heard a lot around the education piece and how it works, but now Dr. Catanzaro, who happens to be one of our great dynamic leaders, not only of this college, but of our community, is going to talk a little bit about what Chattanooga State is doing in terms of linking to industry, because ultimately, that is the customer of all of these educational processes. We are so fortunate to have Dr. Catanzaro, not only in Chattanooga, but now part of the STEM Higher Education Council, because he has been a college president for 36 years. He started when he was 10. He's been at Chattanooga State for 24 years as our college president, and started out at HR in manufacturing. So he really understands the entire process of this. And not only that, he is one of these leaders that not only cares about what's going on in the industry, et cetera, but really cares about our community. To that vein, he has a PhD, he's studied at Wharton, and he is also very involved with the community on helping to foster small businesses. We have a small business accelerator that Chattanooga State helps run with 74 businesses, and he even houses a STEM high school on the college campus. So it's just wonderful to have a partnership like that with Chattanooga State, and I won't take any more time, and I will turn it over to Jim to share more about what they're doing to really meet the needs of industry in our community.
And great to have a dynamic person like Sheila and Dane as well, who brings so much to our community and brings so much to our college and to me, because they are great entrepreneurs. And we talked a lot about entrepreneurship here in the last couple of hours. Well, what I want to do is focus really on our partnerships with corporations, mainly here in the greater Chattanooga area. We have, over the last year, we've been doing training with 103 companies, separate companies. It all added up to a little over 320,000 hours of training, 15,478 individuals, by the way, who were engaged in training through these corporate partnerships. And if you'll go to the next slide, you can see that right in our mission statement, which was developed a number of years ago, we recognize that our role is not just to change the lives of individuals and to deal with undergraduates of all ages and backgrounds, but really to focus on developing the capacities of business, industry, and the communities within our area and beyond. And so if you go to the next slide, we, over time, tried to crystallize what it is that has made us successful in these partnerships. And I think the first thing is really the most important thing. We've engaged with them in a paradigm shift. I think it took place actually about 5 years ago when we started working with Volkswagen. We realized a number of things because of their German background, and we realized also what they expected of us in terms of training and preparation of the workforce. And the first thing that they expected of us is that we act like a supplier. And, you know, if you look at their supply portfolio for windshields, it's 40 pages long of the specifics of what they want in a windshield that's going to be supplied to them for the Passat. Well, what is it that they want in training and education? It's actually that specific. And so when we work with them shoulder to shoulder in designing the curriculum and the programs that we have, that's when it became very clear to us that we have been starting in the wrong place. We need to start in every business and every activity that we engage in, we believe, with industry itself. And when you look at that 30-70, what you're looking at is 30% theory, 70% applied. So it's also a shift in that regard. It's a shift away from the classical education model to focusing in on what people do when they enter the workforce and when they operate in the workforce. And so we're very performance focused, as you can see, dealing with not just workplace discipline, but we do the onboarding for Volkswagen for a number of companies, that is orientation to them, all the way up to executive development. And it almost always has components of workplace discipline, teamwork, cultural alignment, aligning
the employee with the corporate values and even with national values when we're speaking about international companies. And then very important, and I think quite uniquely, we really focus in on power language. Here we are in the South, and let's admit it, people speak sometimes strange languages here. And some of them are inner city languages, some of them are rural languages. What can we do? And we say to them, that's perfectly okay when you go to your neighborhood, into your home, speak whatever language you want. But not when it comes to working in major American companies or international companies. It just can't be done that way. And more than that, we need to be focused on language that is very specific. Language, we don't have a language, English, that's like German, that can deliver us very specifically to communication. So we have to develop within the English language those capabilities so that we speak precisely, we use our critical reasoning skills, and we amplify them by the use of power language, as we call it. And then we've really come to this mainly, again, from our relationship with German companies, and that is this focus on mastery, wall-to-wall mastery. And wall-to-wall mastery is more than competency. It is you cannot move to Unit 2 from Unit 1 until you have truly mastered Unit 1. And the same goes all the way through, which means you have to pretty much abandon ideas about doing everything within a semester or a certain time frame. You have to allow people to work faster than that time frame may have suggested, or even go beyond a semester. And maybe it takes them a whole year to finish what would otherwise be learned in a semester. Anyway, these become the basis for relationships with business and industry, our partnerships, and we design them to be long-term relationships. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see that our three partners, principal partners that I've selected out as examples out of the 103 that we dealt with are Volkswagen, this major $2.4 billion plant that was built 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago here in Greater Chattanooga. The Tennessee Valley Authority, which is the largest supplier of power in the United States. And then Wacker Chemical that has just recently come to us with a $2.4 billion investment in high purity polysilicon. And each one, if you go to the next slide, you'll see we're involved in a very different level in each of those. So 320,000 plus hours of training, 210,000 of them took place at the Volkswagen Academy, this large 165,000 square foot facility, state-of-the-art facility. Everything from corporate culture to automation to assembly to lean manufacturing, we cover every base for Volkswagen. 61 plants, Volkswagen plants worldwide. 60 of them have a training entity called Volkswagen Coaching. It's a division of Volkswagen. Only one has an outside provider, and that's right here, and it's Chattanooga State Community College. And with them, in partnership, we developed a 2-3-year mechatronics program based on the German apprenticeship model, which has led to German Chamber of Commerce certification. And it just shows what can be done if we think outside the box. Yes, community colleges are have two-year programs, but no, mechatronics can't be taught, we think, effectively in 2 years. So we teach it in 9 semesters, and 5 of those are in classroom, and 4 of them every other semester is a semester of on-the-job training paid for by Volkswagen in the plant, and then you come back for another classroom experience, and that classroom experience now makes a lot more sense because you've been out in the plant. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see what we do a little bit here with the Tennessee Valley Authority. In this case, they're not so much interested in non-credit instruction or training. They're really interested in college degrees. So we developed 4 Associate of Applied Science degrees directly for them, and mainly for their power, 3 nuclear power plants, as you can see, nuclear power engineering and so forth. And this is a relationship we've had really for almost the 24 years I've been here. I jumped over there, went over there to see them after I joined the college here back in 1990. And soon after that, we began to develop this relationship. And we're the principal supplier now for the people that are running these plants, operating these plants, both in the control room and throughout the plant itself. So you go to the next slide, you can see what we're doing with Wacker Chemie, the polysilicone provider. We won the 2014 Bellwether Award for Corporate Partnerships through this installation. And that happens to be a picture of the world's largest chemical training plant. It's all glass so that you can see the process. Every student can see the process as well as control the process. You can see blue there. We use blue dye. If you ever see it in amber color, you know they're not producing what we're asking them to produce. They're producing something like Jack Daniels, which is up the road. So so we make sure it's blue so we can really see the distinction and know how things are going. And obviously, we're focused mainly on chemical operations and lab technicians. These people are paid $45,000 to $55,000 to start. And we learned a lot from this, because when they first came to us and we built this installation, they said to us, well, look, the normal track is 3 semesters over 18 months, 43 credit units in the core courses in chemical engineering technology. And then they told us, well, because we're going to start up soon, we would really like to have an advanced group of 50 to 51 chemical operators fully trained within 6 months. So we took those 43 units, already squeezed, compressed, into a 3-semester program and forced them into a 6-month program. And lo and behold, the students who started every day, Monday through Friday at 8 in the morning and didn't leave until 10 at night, outperformed the students that we've had in the 3-semester program in the traditional 2-year college, 2-year degree program, and outperformed all the German students that came through their training program, many of them who started actually at age 12 or 13 in preparation for this responsibility. So it taught us that you can compress some instruction and actually get an even a better result out of it. So if you go to the next slide, you can see just some of the things that we've done with various companies like McKee Foods and Whirlpool and Wrigley and the like. And it's taken a whole different set of training to satisfy these folks. Some people want Six Sigma black belt courses, and other people just want skilled maintenance and tool and die. What one thing that we've done, and it's been, I think, good for our college and certainly good for our community, is we've become very resourceful folks. We ourselves have to be entrepreneurial. And in essence, when a new company comes our way, we never say we're going to pull something off the shelf to offer to them. We just say we're going to start at ground zero. So if you go to the next slide, which is the slide you saw before, then you're going to see that we always start in this partnership. Yes, we go to them and we say we're going to jointly develop this curriculum. The way we teach and have all these elements in it as you wish. We've learned something really from the Volkswagen experience, and that is they not only are specific about what they want done through training, but they want us to mark out every 15-minute segment what the outcomes will be, what gains we will make through training 15 minutes by 15 minutes. Pretty extraordinary. That's kind of what we're about, and it's been a lot of fun, and hopefully this has been of some value to you folks as well and to the connector.
Thank you, Jim. That was a terrific presentation. Thank you, Sheila, too, for introducing us to Chattanooga State. It's an amazing TVA, Volkswagen, and this Wacker Chemie. Congratulations on the award. We're going to move on. We're running short on time. So thank you very much. And I'm going to find my colleague here, Chad Womack from UNCF, and I'm going to ask my colleague from across the table, so I'll be switching cameras, Talmisha Richards, to introduce Chad. Let's see if this works. Okay, maybe it's working. Try that again. I might need to turn the camera on and off. There we go. There's Taumisha. And she's not Ted Wells. So go ahead, Taumisha.
Good afternoon, everyone. Dr. Chad Womack is the first PhD graduate of Morehouse School of Medicine's Biomedical Sciences program, and he completed his postdoctoral fellowship at the NIH. After leaving NIH, Dr. Womack founded or co-founded several innovation and technology-based companies, nonprofit organizations, and STEM initiatives, including 3-Gen Vaccines Incorporated and the America 21 Project. Currently, Dr. Womack is the director of the prestigious UNCF Merck's Fellowship Program and also leads UNCF's Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics initiatives. Dr. Womack is actively working to increase R&D innovation, technology transfer, commercialization, and entrepreneurship across HBCU campuses. Chad?
Hi. Can you hear me okay?
You're good.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Ted, you queuing up the slides?
I'm getting those ready. Hang on. Just start talking, and we'll get them up.
Uh-oh. You have to say something? No, I'm just kidding. It's a great pleasure and honor to be able to share with you the vision for STEM initiatives across the historically black college and university landscape. I work at the UNCF as the National STEM Director, and in my capacity as STEM Director, I coordinate, manage, and direct several programs, one of which is the UNCF Merck Science Initiative, which includes the UNCF Merck Fellowship Program, which funds and supports 15 undergraduate, 10 postdoc, and 12 graduate African Americans in the biolife science pipeline. And we're proud to say that we've produced over 600 top quality scientists, biomedical engineers, biolife scientists over the past 18 years since the program was founded in 1996. Of course, the UNCF, people know from my mind, is a terrible thing to waste, and we now have included but a wonderful thing to invest in. The UNCF represents 36 private historically black colleges, but also as a key and leading HBCU stakeholder, the UNCF represents the HBCU community. Happy to say that we launched this effort at the White House called the HBCU Innovation, Commercialization, and Entrepreneurship Platform, or ICE, back in 2012. One of our key milestones was met in 2013 with the launch of the inaugural HBCU Innovation Summit in Silicon Valley, which was held in the fall of 2013. And we established the ICE platform as a collaborative, partnership-driven platform that basically includes the UNCF, the APLU, which is the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities, which includes all the public HBCUs and minority-serving institutions, and the White House HBCU initiative itself. Dr. John Lee, who's vice president at APLU, is a partner to this effort, along with Dr. George Cooper, who's the executive director at the White House HBCU initiative. Next slide, please. So our vision is to envision a world in which African-American youth are STEM literate, empowered to address 21st century challenges and opportunities as innovators and entrepreneurs, and where HBCUs serve as vibrant nodes and hubs of innovation. Our mission is very much focused on increasing the post-secondary yield of African-Americans pursuing STEM careers and to foster innovation and entrepreneurship across our campuses, leading in R&D, commercialization, and tech entrepreneurship. Our goals are to increase the number of HBCU STEM graduates, enhance member institutions, launch a national advocacy platform that will broaden and diversify the narrative around STEM opportunities, engage and increase the public sector investment and access for African Americans in STEM, and facilitate and leverage investment capital for deal flow. Next slide, please. So the question is, what are we trying to accomplish? Number one, we want to change and align the narrative around underrepresented minority achievement in STEM with the UNCF Better Futures campaign. We're focused on trying to move the understanding about what's possible for African-American students and underrepresented minorities writ large in STEM fields. Secondly, we want to empower HBCU students and faculty members to pursue tech and social entrepreneurship. Third, we want to build innovation capacity and assets at our institutions. And fourth, connect our institutions and the STEM pipeline to opportunities in local and regional innovation ecosystems. Next slide, please. So what is the UNCF STEM ICE initiative? It's really a STEM pipeline to market initiative that broadens and aligns existing STEM educational workforce development R&D efforts across our HBCUs with opportunities in the innovation tech economy. And what we mean by that really is we want to align the STEM educational workforce efforts with the economy. For far too long, we felt that the educational pipeline is misaligned with economic outcomes and outputs. And so we want to realign that and reassert the notion that it's not just about getting a degree, it's also about getting the skills and the abilities that will empower our students and our faculty and empower our institutions to be the innovators and leaders, not just job seekers, while that's important, but also job creators. So we start with the pipeline itself. And the program that I direct, the UNCF Merck program, serves as a wonderful example, where we support 37 African Americans at various levels from undergraduate to graduate and postdoc to pursue their hopes and their dreams in the biolife science space. But there are over 40 or 50 different programs that the UNCF runs and manages that are STEM related. Some corporate, some foundation, some individual gift-based programs, but they are all focused on supporting scholarships, programs, internships, and fellowships, which is actually a division inside the UNCF. That flows into the ICE segment of the pipeline. And we're actually very proud to be a partner to STEMconnector. We're talking about doing a variety of programs and activities together. Well, one of the things that we're pursuing more immediately with HBCUs writ large is trying to get our students involved in computer science and engineering or IT related skills building activities. Hackathons are great for that, and one of the things that we're establishing is the HBCU Hackathon League. We're happy to say that we're considering launching that with the next summit in November of this year. And so the actual competition serves as a capstone component to the league itself. We're also launching R&D affinity networks and centers of excellence. And the idea behind that is that we're trying to expand and enhance HBCU research capabilities across our campuses. Not that we would impact every single campus, but that we identify the ones that are strongly aligned with industry verticals like cybersecurity, big data analytics, biotech, green tech, etc., and connect them to, on the one end, federal R&D grant programs, but on the other with industry. The last segment of the ICE component of the platform and pipeline is strategic partnerships and business opportunities. We see the Innovation Summit as an opportunity to strengthen and highlight our strategic partnerships in Silicon Valley and around the country. In terms of business opportunities, we're creating the opportunity for HBCUs to connect via a virtual commercialization center that leverages the strengths of those HBCUs that have particular strengths in those areas. And we're also considering, not in the immediate, but at some point, creating and establishing an HBCU Innovation Fund that would serve to provide seed capital across our campuses. Next slide, please. So what are our targets? Clearly, we want to impact our students and our faculty. They're the bullseye. But around that, we also want to impact our institutions. And then certainly around that, we want to impact the African-American community and other students that don't necessarily happen to attend HBCUs but might attend majority institutions. And then, of course, the last ring is society at large. Next slide, please. Our outcomes include empowering our students and faculty to launch ventures, STEM curriculum transformation, aligning the curriculum with economic outputs and assumptions in terms of preparing students with skills and abilities that are relevant for the tech economy, We want our on-campus culture across our HBCUs to be transformed. We want faculty members and students to take risks. We want students to consider becoming entrepreneurs, faculty to consider launching tech companies. We want our HBCU institutions to become hubs and nodes of innovation and entrepreneurship. And I want to pause and say that, you know, we're not starting from scratch. Many of our HBCUs are doing wonderful things already. North Carolina A&T, for instance, has an energy resource center that's NSF funded. Howard has a burgeoning innovation center that they're putting together. So does Clark Atlanta University. My alma mater, Morehouse College, is now creating innovative things. Spelman is doing some wonderful things around innovation as well. Morgan State as well. There are a lot of campuses within the HBCU community that are doing some wonderful things. The point of the STEM ICE platform is to aggregate those resources and assets that can be distributed across the HBCU landscape, leveraged and strengthened in alignment with the economy. Next slide, please. So the framework of the ICE platform is threefold. One is advocacy and media platform. We've actually established the HBCUinnovation.org as the online digital media component of the platform. Secondly, innovation and entrepreneurship. Thirdly, ecosystem development. Ecosystem development is perhaps the penultimate goal towards really creating or establishing the entire community as a vibrant STEM innovation community. Ecosystem development really involves plugging in our campuses to their local and regional innovation ecosystems. A lot of our schools are within cities and regions that are teeming with opportunities. Clark Atlanta, Morehouse College, Spelman, for instance, sit within a burgeoning Greater Atlanta innovation ecosystem. Howard is here in DC, Morgan State in Baltimore, so on and so on. We're hoping that while we're developing on-campus capacities, that we connect those capacities to what's going on in the larger ecosystems. Next slide, please. We have six major goals. I'll just focus on the ones for 2014. The first goal is to really leverage the success of the HBCU Innovation Summit in Silicon Valley as an opportunity to share best practices and lessons learned. Secondly, establish and build out our online media platform, hbcuinnovation.org. Establish an HBCU-wide hackathon league as a platform that would engage students and faculty. There are three other goals that we have established, but we're going to focus on the first three with the hope that we can execute and really lead in towards the last three in 2015 and 2016. Next slide, please. A little bit of the history. This really came out of a White House tech inclusion project that I launched back in 2012 called the HBCU Startup and Innovation Initiative. That evolved into the STEM ICE initiative at UNCF. Simultaneously and unbeknownst to me and to each other, my colleague Dr. John Lee was also launching an HBCU innovation initiative that he called Innovation Entrepreneurship Coalition. In 2013, we decided to join forces and bring in the White House HBCU initiative, and that formed the HBCU Center for STEM Innovation, Commercialization, Entrepreneurship, or what we call ICE. Next slide, please. These are the partners and founding and principal partners of the HBCU ICE platform, APLU, UNCF, and the White House. Next slide, please. And these are our partners in Silicon Valley. We're happy to say that Stanford, in particular the Center for Professional Development, and the EPICENTER, which is Engineering Pathways for Innovation Center, which is NSF funded, the Kpoor Center for Social Impact, Silicon Valley Bank, and the NCIIA are all major partners and supporters of this effort. Many, many others have stepped up to play a very supportive role. Google, Facebook, Andreessen Horowitz, Code2040, Venture for America, SpaceX, and Texas Instruments as well. Next slide, please. In our first summit, we were hosted by Facebook, And what you see here are several of our HBCU presidents. In the middle, you'll see Dr. Beverly Tatum, who's second to the penultimate to the right. Next to my colleague Ken Tulsa from the White House HBCU Initiative, Dr. Carlton Brown is in the back. Dr. Lomax, who's CEO of the UNCF, is in the middle. Just to point out that we had very high-level participation in the first and second summit. In the March, we had a symposium in which many of our HBCU deans and provosts were present. Next slide, please. We were happy to be greeted by Sheryl Sandberg herself, who presented where Facebook was headed in the future and the need for a tech workforce, a diverse tech workforce. Next slide, please. Finally, I want to talk about one of the projects that we're working on right now that we've actually launched, but we're hoping to revamp, called the HBCU Technology and Entrepreneurship Center. It's an online it's a component of the online platform, hbcuinnovation.org, that we're building out that will serve as an online hub for students and faculty who are really interested in getting involved in the tech industry. And we're happy to say that this has been supported by the Blackstone Charitable Foundation. We're hoping to expand that in preparation for the next summit. Next slide, please. And last but not least, in 2015, we're looking to co-host a STEM Diversity Summit with STEMconnector. We're honored to be able to work with Edie Frazier and her staff and team, Dr. Talmisha Richards and others. And we're very excited about the opportunity that this may afford to showcase best practices, talent in and among underrepresented minorities, institutions, schools, and programs that address the issue of STEM diversity. So I'll end by saying we are honored to be part of the Higher Educational Council. It's a pleasure to get to know STEMconnector team and our colleagues as part of the council. We're looking forward to sharing what we're learning and what we're doing with others, and look forward to engaging you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chad. I'm going to switch it from Talmisha back to me. I just realized I had the wrong camera on. Thanks, Chad. That's great. And you guys are a terrific partner, and it's been awesome to work with you this year. Apologies to all. This is going to be archived, so we've got some extra time. I'm going to just turn it over. Don, are you able to talk briefly?
Yeah, I can do this a short version for everybody's benefit.
Okay. Don Munz from the National Research Center for College and University Admissions, also known as My College Options, has been a partner with STEMconnector for a few years now, and Don and his son Ryan are really a great team out of Kansas City, and are probably one of the best kept secrets in terms of data about people coming through our higher education system, and the pipeline really, and so Don's going to talk about some of the work that we're doing together, and I'll turn it over to you, Don, so we don't waste any more time.
Well, that's great. While you're pulling the slides up, Ted, I'll share with the group that we're very excited about this partnership, and for several years we've worked with you in the high schools to enroll students in a college planning program. That college planning program allows students to tell us what they want to be when they grow up, and then we work with colleges and universities to make the connection. We've been at this for about 40 years. We're known by most of the admissions offices on the Higher Ed Council. Most of the admissions offices in the United States use us as a way to connect with prospective students. But when Edie and the group shared with us the goals of the Higher Ed Council, we began to think about how we could prepare a report that might be helpful in helping each of the institutions that join the Higher Ed Council understand the marketplace that they're in as it relates to high school students and their interest in STEM. So what you'll be seeing in just a moment is, and we're going to go through it very quickly, is a report that we've generated for Rob at Des Moines Area Community College. This is a report that's generated by compiling the information from the Des Moines area schools, and in that research, we're able to identify who's interested in STEM and what areas of STEM interest do they have. this is a pretty fascinating subject because we're able to watch through other reports that we have prepared for the STEM Connector and others that we've got a big challenge in this country, and we all know about it. The challenge is that young people enter high school, they may or may not have an interest in one of the STEM-related careers, but during the course of high school, there are a lot of challenges. A lot of things get in the way of them pursuing their dreams and their aspirations. Some of the things that get in the way might be very difficult classes. Other things may be faculty at the high school level that aren't really prepared to talk to students about what is involved in a technology-related career in today's world. And so we have a multitude of challenges. But what we're going to show, if Ted can pull it up, is just some data on high school students today that are in the Des Moines area. And for those of you on the call who are representing other institutions of higher education, this report is going to be provided as a part of your membership in the STEM Connector Higher Education Council. We are working on the details of getting the report to automatically generate for us so that we can produce it more quickly than we were able to produce the Des Moines report. But we've got that ready, and maybe we're taking about as long as it takes you, Ted, to bring it up for us. Challenges? I see you talking, but I don't hear you. Am I still the guy live on the... Well, I'm assuming that I'm the one that's still live as we're looking at Ted, but for those of you on the call, as I said, the report will detail things about students based on their racial background and their interest in STEM. It will also detail what areas of STEM they're interested in and what types of colleges they're thinking about in terms of preparing for their future careers. So, Ted, I don't know, are we going to give up or are we still trying? It's really a nice report, too. Maybe the folks at Google Hangout have decided that we've been on this call for too long. I'm not hearing you, Ted. Are you trying to talk to me? Well, once again, not sure if I'm on or what's happening. I've pulled up on my own instrument, my iPad here. I've got the report. A report will detail things like national trends compared to the local market. So for a university, they're able to look at specifically what kinds of things are happening in the high school student perceptions of STEM and interest in STEM and how that relates or compares to national norms. Are we giving up?
Hello.
I can hear you, Rob. I think we're kind of having some issues.
I will say that, Don, I received the report for DMAC. Boy, what a model. I just responded to your son, Ryan, that I hopefully tonight will be back at home. I'm out of town yet. But we'll have a chance to look over. But, boy, it's amazing the kind of data you have. And I think every time I look at it, it raises three more questions, but boy, your site is great, so we're really looking forward to that as it goes down the road. So.
Well, yeah, hopefully we'll have an opportunity, particularly with the members, the institutional members, to create those reports and get those discussions going. But you're absolutely right, Rob. Going through the findings in each metro area will be extremely interesting for the local groups to see, the local institutions to see how they compare and what's going on in their education space and what the high school students are thinking about doing. We've got a very interesting report that tells every institution what colleges the students are thinking about enrolling in, and it sort of ranks them from 1 to 15, and it's pretty fascinating. I'm sure when you're at Des Moines Area Community College and you look at the local heavyweights like Iowa State and Iowa, and students are thinking about going there, but certainly your reputation is strong, and you're one of those institutions that students are looking to prepare for their future. And the challenge is to create the innovation that engages high school students before they start to lose their interest. Yeah. I just really feel that from the work we do with high school students, so many of them struggle with making the connection to real life. They're interested in STEM, they're interested in particularly in technology careers, and somehow they lose the momentum to get there because they don't make that connection. So we're hoping to help in this process by helping institutions and industry and others have a way to actually communicate and connect with students while they're still making their plans. And that's sort of our goal.
All right, Ted, with your permission, I'm going to go ahead and kind of wrap up because I know we're significantly over time. Just two things. It's amazing that even though I've got the PowerPoint in front of me, I've still got 6 pages of notes. So it's been a great conversation, a lot of follow-ups required. In the rest of the PowerPoint, you'll see the DMAC STEM Higher Education STEM Council at DMAC. STEMconnector's got a great model for how we organize internally our colleges to really coalesce the silos around STEM. Then you'll see a notice of the October 8th summit for STEM for Higher Education Council members. 25 of our schools and our best business partners will be gathered in New York at the Academy of Sciences to really have an intense day, out of which a book will come talking about those best practices on the demand side of delivering a STEM workforce. So we're very excited about that. And the last slide, it has the contact information for Edie, Ted, and myself. Anything you've heard today or any additional points you need to make, or if you want contact information for any of our speakers, please let us know. Because, again, this is a process that we want to get information out, and I know that I'm going to be following up on some things, and we'll try to figure out a way that everybody can see where we might be going as we develop this pipeline of STEM workers, and particularly the higher ed role. So to all of our presenters, thank you very much. It's been a long day, but I tell you, very, very exciting, and we will make sure that the Don's slides are on the PowerPoint so that you can see it. It's DMAC information, and as he mentioned, I saw where all the students in our area are thinking of going to school, and I was just as interested in those above me as I am those below me. And probably I was glad a few were below me that I would have been otherwise concerned about. But anyway, thank you all so much to the 500 of you. If your institution is interested in the Higher Ed Council, the contact information is on the back, last slide. But it's an exciting process, and I look forward to future seminars and town halls where we'll showcase others of our Higher Ed Council and what they're doing. So thank you all very much.